So with this lecture series, we're going to go ahead and start macroeconomics in earnest. And the first thing we need to do is talk about how to measure what's going on in the macroeconomy, how to measure what's going on in the economy as a whole. And the first thing we're going to look at is gross domestic product. Just before we go in, remember the difference between micro and macroeconomics. Microeconomics is going to be the study of small sectors of the economy in a relatively high level of detail. So we might be studying the restaurant industry or the auto industry, or we might study consumer behavior in a fairly high level of detail. How do people make decisions about retirement and that sort of thing? Macroeconomics deals with questions about how the economy as a whole is doing. So when people talk about what the inflation rate is, or what's going on with recessions or booms, or why some countries are relatively rich and other countries are relatively poor, those are essentially macroeconomic questions. Another thing I want to call your memory back to is the idea of the circular flow diagram. So remember in the circular flow diagram, this is a very simple model of the economy, and we have two types of actors in this simple model. We have firms and we have households, and households, of course, engage in spending for finished goods and services, also called output. Their spending is revenue for firms, and then firms pay out their revenues either as wages or as profits or that sort of stuff to households. And so we can see that really there are a couple different ways of looking at the amount of spending and production in the economy. We can look at the spending side of it. We could count up total economic activity by counting total spending. We could count up total economic activity by counting the revenue that firms earn. We could count up total economic activity by counting the different types of income, or just by counting up total income in itself. But fundamentally, notice, when we look at things in a macroeconomic context, revenue and spending and income and production are all the same thing, because everything that is people spending money on, firms are producing those goods and services. So again, emphasizing, when we're looking in macroeconomics, we're going to treat income, expenditure, production, output. These are all different ways of saying the same thing. And gross domestic product is how we measure that. So the idea of gross domestic product is that we're going to measure or figure out a way to measure total economic activity. And mostly we're going to concentrate on measuring this by total expenditures, but we could also think about total income. The definition of GDP turns out to be a little bit long-winded, and the exact wording is actually very important. So we're going to go ahead and walk through this kind of slowly. So the words in red are the actual definition, and then the words underneath in black are commentary on that particular clause or phrase in the definition. So one thing is, how do we compare apples and oranges? Well, we compare apples and oranges at their market value. So we go ahead and use the actual transactions price, because we know that even if we have a market that's non-competitive or not fully competitive, consumers will buy the product up to where the value the marginal buyer places on the good equals its price. So that's essentially why we use market prices as our way of measuring the value of the goods. Okay, we're going to measure everything that happens inside an economy. So it's gross domestic product. The domestic refers to it occurring inside an economy. And we include everything that's actually transacted sort of above the table. So we're going to exclude things that are illegal products or illegal transactions. And we're also going to exclude home production. So if someone raises crops and eats them, or if someone takes care of their own children, that doesn't contribute towards GDP. On the other hand, if your neighbor raises some crops and sells them to you, and you all report that, then that's going to count as part of GDP. Likewise, if you hire your next door neighbor to watch your kids, that's a market transaction, and that's going to be counted. The tricky thing here in this definition, GDP is the market value of all final goods and services. And the idea of final goods and services gets people pretty tripped up here. The idea here is that we want to exclude what's called an intermediate good. And the way to think about this is if you buy a gallon of gasoline for your personal consumption, then that's the final sale. You buy it, it burns up, and it's gone, and that's all there is to it. But if someone like a trucker or a taxi driver buys fuel, then the price of the fuel is included in the price of the services they provide. Likewise, if a company buys raw materials like wood and then turns them into furniture, the price of the wood is included in the price of the furniture. So we only want to count those things once. By using this final goods idea here, we're going to get around the accidental double counting problem. So GDP is the market value of all final goods and services produced within a country in a given period of time. It's not always within a country. So we could sort of look at the gross domestic product of California or the gross domestic product of Humboldt County or something like that. Or we could look at global gross domestic product. But most of the time, we analyze things by looking at what happens within a national border. And finally, as it says here, in a given period of time, GDP is what happens in a year or typically in a year or a 3 month period called a quarter. Last thing to talk about here is this idea of GDP and hidden markets. And notice there are two sorts, or maybe three sorts of markets that are hidden. There's at-home transactions, which are sort of completely hidden, and they're not even really transactions, but they are production. And then there are, within hidden markets, there's two sorts here. There would be true black markets where people are transacting in illegal products. And then there would be legal services and legal goods that people are transacting under the table. And one thing we see out there is that there are differences between different countries about how much of economic activity is occurring off the books and under the table, or is black market activity. So the estimates are that in the general US economy, if we sort of take together the black and informal markets, the informal markets are things that are happening under the table but legal otherwise, that these hidden markets are about 10% of what's happening in the above the board markets. In Europe, we see that it's probably more like 20 to 30%, and in many third world countries, it's up something like 50%. And I'll probably save for a discussion in class exactly why that is.